Welcome to worship on this second Sunday of Advent with the Bridgewater Church of the Brethren, a congregation who seeks to follow Jesus and live the love of God. Wherever you are welcome. You can learn more about our congregation at bwcob.org. I'm Christy Dowdy, the interim pastor. I want you to know that Advent devotionals, which look like this, are available on our portico in a tub. You can pick them up, or please, if you'd like one to have it mailed, just call the church office and we'd be glad to get it to you. Certainly, your offerings are always a gift when they're received at the church. It's easy to give online on our website again, or mail it to the church, of course, always works by snail mail. We're again inviting everyone to participate in our Christmas offering if you have the means to do that this year. We have three primary designations for the monies received: locally for the Mountain Valley Elementary School Book Drive, also Central Valley Habitat for Humanity. And then beyond our community, monies will be sent to Brethren Disaster Ministries, where monies are always needed in many different places. May you dream and take action to support this special offering during this coming month. Indeed, we were very saddened to learn on Friday of the need for Pastor Chris's family to gather around his mother's bedside and to express their goodbyes as she suffered another major stroke on Thursday and was put on a ventilator. She had been placed there, and we know she had faced such difficult times prior to her stroke this last summer. We certainly hold Chris, Amanda, Shyla, and Tristan in our continued love and prayers at this difficult time. And I'd offer a moment for us to lift up our individual prayers for Pastor Chris and all of his family. Let's take a moment to pray now. Amen. I am also thankful for Mark Dowdy, who was able to step in and compile this video for today's worship so Chris could be with his family. The theme we have chosen for these weeks of Advent is entitled Those Who Dream, from the Sanctified Arts Group. Again, in this season when we're bound so closely to our homes and not encouraged to go beyond that bubble, what does it look like as those of us who dream? I invite you now to listen to this call to worship.
John the Baptist said, "Prepare the way." So family and friends, how do we prepare our minds for worship?
We silence the inner critic. We let go of busy thoughts. We make space for God to speak.
How do we prepare our hearts for worship? We bless all emotions. We feel what we feel. We open ourselves up to be moved.
How do we prepare our bodies for worship? We take in the sense, sight, and feel of the space. We breathe in God's mercy. We exhale God's love.
How do we prepare our souls for worship? We bring our full selves into our space. We wear our hearts on our sleeves. We trust that even now, God is here.
Yes. Wherever you are, God is present. So may we prepare ourselves and as much as possible bring our full selves into our space. To help each of us individually prepare, I invite you to listen again to this harp music played by Ann Daggett and friends, recorded recently at the Muhlenberg Lutheran Church. For no matter where we are, God is with us. Worship is a way of life, not just an event or a physical space. Let us cultivate that sacred space by slowing, by listening, by being still enough to recognize God's presence in our midst, wherever you are.
Good morning, it's Ben Bear. I have a bear with me so you can remember who I am. I'll talk more about the bear in a little bit. The gospel for today is Mark 1, 1 through 8. I was excited to read this because sometimes you read a scripture and there's a song that goes with it, probably based on the scripture, and you know it's based on a scripture, but you don't have the scripture in mind necessarily. And I read this one, and this one is talking about preparing. So it's Mark starting out with the words from the prophet Isaiah, and John the Baptist appears in the wilderness making this powerful announcement, and John draws people from the countryside and from the city and just pulls them away from whatever it is that they're doing and gets them to stop and consider what it means to prepare for the one who is to come. Here's the song. Maybe you know it. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. That's from Godspell. If you haven't seen it, it's kind of out there a little bit at times, but the music is pretty good. And that's one of the songs. Now you can look forward to it. Here's the gospel. This is the beginning of the good news about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As the prophet Isaiah wrote, I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. This is a voice of one who calls out in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make the road straight for him. John was baptizing people in the desert and preaching a baptism of changed hearts and lives for the forgiveness of sins. All the people from Judea and Jerusalem were going out to him. They confessed their sins and were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothes made from camel hair and had a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. This is what John preached to the people. There is one coming after me who's greater than me. I am not good enough to even kneel down and untie his sandal. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
dream of the first pitch of opening day.
I dream of laundry day, where each sock finds its mate.
I dream of family home for the holidays.
I dream of a good book and homemade macaroni.
I dream of Jeep rides with a top down.
These are beautiful dreams, but I also have urgent dreams.
I dream of conversations across party lines.
I dream of more bridges and less walls.
I dream of more laughter and less fear.
I dream of more listening and less tears.
But most of all, I dream of peace for our world. Today, we light the candle of peace.
May this light remind us there is another way.
Hi everyone. I wonder, what's going on in your life? For me, I'm coming to you from in front of my Christmas tree. It's the first time I've done one of these stories upstairs in my house. I'm usually downstairs. So if one of my kitties comes to join me during the story, you know why. What's going on in my life? Well, we're getting ready for Christmas. I hope you've been able to see the children's advent calendar that came out this week in either email or the e-connections, and I hope you've enjoyed seeing some familiar faces and having a few challenges. I know my family certainly enjoyed the Advent season so far. Otherwise, we are just getting ready. School's going okay, trying to stay safe and stay healthy, but keep learning. That's our goal. Stay healthy and keep learning. Now for a story. I was talking with Pastor Christy, and she asked, Josh, could we do another story about somebody with big dreams? And that's a great idea, sticking with this dream theme. And I was thinking about who I should talk about this week, and I heard on the radio that this week was the 65th anniversary of Rosa Parks and her keeping her seat on the bus. And I thought, that's a pretty big dream right there. You know this, I'm going to read you a story. It's called Boycott Blues, How Rosa Parks Inspired a Nation. And to me, it just doesn't get any bigger than that. It was peaceful. Her boycott was peaceful, but it changed the lives for many, 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 many people. And I thought, what a better story could I tell? And I couldn't think of one. So I'm going to share this story with you. I'm going to read it to you. And so my story will be a little longer today than usual. And then we'll say a prayer when I'm finished. It was December 1st, 1955, when the Blues came to call. The same day Jim Crow flew in waving his bony wings. Bony wings and all, Jim Crow landed with a will. Yes, he did, child. Yes, he did. Jim Crow was segregation, laws that said black people and white people could not mix. And on that day, it was Rosa Parks who got Jim Crow's peck, peck, peck right up close. Rosa Parks was a seamstress who worked at the Montgomery Fair department store. On that blue as blue evening, Rosa's workday ended like any other. She stepped onto the Cleveland Avenue bus and paid her dime to ride. But the bus was packed tight. But Rosa spotted an empty seat one row behind the whites only section. She sat down. When the bus pulled up at the Empire Theater, several white people got on. All but one of them found seats. The last was left standing. That's when Jim Crow showed up strutting. Whenever Jim Crow got to laying down the letters of the law to stating the state of segregation, he did it with his peck, peck, peck. And on this day, Jim Crow's peck was a duet. He was letting it fly with the bus driver, who, along with Jim Crow, stood over Rosa and told her to give up her seat to a white man who was still standing. Even with that blue-black wing pressed to Rosa's nose, even with the bus driver's finger waving at Rosa, even with Jim Crow's peck, 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 Rosa stayed seated. Twice the bus driver told Rosa to move. Twice she looked at him without blinking, then turned her eye to Jim Crow, and all she said was, "No." "You're breaking my law," Jim Crow crooned. The bus driver said he'd call the police. Rosa told him to go ahead. The police arrested Rosa and took her to jail. Rosa's friend, Ed Nixon, raised money for Rosa's bail. He got her released and told Rosa that if she were brave enough, she could stomp out Jim Crow. She could break those bony wings. She could stop Jim Crow's peck, peck, peck. She could help end segregation. Rosa agreed right away. On December 5th, 1955, the black people in town stopped riding city buses. They were protesting the treatment Rosa had received. That night at the Holt Street Baptist Church, Martin Luther King Jr. spoke to the people of Montgomery. "Child, child, I've put my doggy tail in that church every Sunday, but I've never seen so many folks at Holt. People came from all over to hear the great Dr. King. He said that we should fight until justice runs down like a mighty stream, and fight we did. We fought a quiet fight. No slingshots, no weapons, not even spitballs. We fought with our feet. We said, if you don't, we don't. If you don't, we won't. If you don't let us ride in any seat we wish, we won't ride at all. If you don't treat us fairly, we won't pay the dime. We won't pay the fare. If we don't pay the fare, you won't have any bus business. And we won't let Jim Crow smack us in the back with his bony wings or slow us up with his peck, peck, peck. We won't. And we stood by our word. Yes, we did. Yes, child, yes, we did. That's when our feet took us to the streets, to the sidewalks, to the roads. That's when the city buses rolled and rolled, nearly empty they rolled. That's when the boycott blues truly began, when we walked with dogged feet, with dog-tired feet, with boycott blues. Ninety days passed. We kept on. 100 days gone. We stayed strong. Walked in the rain, we did. Walked day and night, we did. Walked for our fight, we did. Yes, we did. Child, we did.
120 days, 130, 150. Walk to work, we did. Walk to school, we did. Walk to church, we did. Yes, we did, child. Yes, we did. 180 days of walking, 100 degrees in the shade. Sidewalks steaming, sweaty faces gleaming. Hot dust rising off the roads. And the buses rolled and rolled. When the blues burned so hot, so blue hot, that the turned our beat to a deep blue shade of determination, we found a way out of no way. We found other modes to get us where we needed to go. Soon, instead of only walking, we rode. Rode with our friends, we did. Rode with kind strangers, we did. Rode past those empty buses, we did. Uh-huh, we did. Yes, child, we did. Didn't set foot on a bus either. No, sir, we didn't. Wouldn't pay our dime to ride either. Uh-uh. We still got where we needed to go. We still stood by Rosa Parks for saying no. But Jim Crow, he was determined too. He kept up with his bony wings and his peck, peck, peck. 200 days later, we were still going blues and all. We pressed on. It wasn't all black folk boycotting either. Some white people came along for the ride too to show us support to help end Jim Crow. Soon there were all kinds of people with keep going feet, who can't stop us feet. There were black folks and white folks with the boycott blues. And time walked on and on. Day 220, day 262, 300 days of walking with the boycott blues. As strong as we were, some wanted to quit. And child, child, I can't say I blame them. After all, when you've been walking from December to November, a bus begins to look like a sweet temptation, even if it means riding in the back, even if Jim Crow sits on your lap. When I saw somebody start to go down that road, when I heard somebody say, "What's the use? I'm paying my dime to ride," I played my guitar as loud as I could drown out Jim Crow's peck, 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 to stir up a rhythm worth following, to somehow soften those boycott blues. Just a few steps and we're there. I strummed, my message was loud and clear. Then came a miracle. The Supreme Court invited Jim Crow in for a visit and waved a gavel in his bony wings. The judge in the courthouse said, "Jim, you're all wrong." Right then, Jim Crow grew tired. His bony wings started to ache. His peck, peck, peck began to lose its point. Oh, child, that was a happy day. On November 13th, 1956, when the Supreme Court struck down the segregation laws, the bus drivers of Montgomery, Alabama were forced to say, "We will. We will let black people sit wherever they want on city buses. We will not practice segregation anymore." And the black folk of Montgomery said, "We will. We will pay our dime. We will ride with pride. We will sit at the front of the bus and enjoy our view of justice." On December 21st, 1956, the law was official. Soon after, black people had a front row seat right behind the driver. So did Rosa Parks. That was day 382, when Jim Crow flew away. He had no more power in Montgomery. It was the blues that got us through. It was the blues that helped our stride, because blue is so fine color when it's painting the sky. Blue is the promise that of possibility when coming up on us as the dawn. Blue is all the beauty when it's flowing through a sea of hope. Now segregation was a loser's croon, and child, child, we rejoiced. Our lowdown tune changed to a celebration song. So child, child, that's the end of my tale. Now you know how it goes. Now you see the power of won't stop shoes. Now you know the story of the boycott blues. Time to hightail it home. Bony wings adieu. Peck, 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 later for you. Bye-bye, boycott blues.
Is that not a story of peace or what? I love the story of Rosa Parks and how everything they did it peacefully. They did it together. And it was actually pretty simple. And that's a saying that we hear a lot in our church, peacefully, simply, together. Will you say a prayer with me before we go? Lord, thank you for all the dreamers, and especially for Rosa Parks, who had such a big dream, a big, peaceful dream. Amen. See you soon, I hope.
Our second reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. And again, there's a song that goes with it. I read the first line and immediately thought of hymn number 176. I'm going to sing the first sentence for you. So if you're familiar with it, maybe it'll run through your head while I'm speaking as well. Comfort, comfort, O my people, speak of peace, now says our God. It's a fun hymn. If you don't know it, check it out. It kind of bounces along like it should be a pirate chanty or something. Isaiah 40, 1 through 11, from the New Century Version. Your God says, comfort, comfort my people. Speak kindly to the people of Jerusalem and tell them that their time of service is finished, that they have paid for their sins, that the Lord has punished Jerusalem twice for every sin they did. This is the voice of one who calls out. Prepare in the desert the way for the Lord. Make a straight road in the dry lands for our God. Every valley should be raised up, and every mountain and hill should be made flat. The rough ground should be made level, and the rugged ground should be made smooth. Then the glory of the Lord will be shown, and all people together will see it. The Lord himself said these things. A voice says, cry out! Then I said, what shall I cry out? Say, all people are like the grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass dies and the flowers fall when the breath of the Lord blows on them. Surely the people are like the grass. The grass dies and the flowers fall, but the word of our God will live forever. Jerusalem, you have good news to tell. Go up on a high mountain. Shout out loud. The good news! Shout it out and don't be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. Look, the Lord God is coming with power to rule all the people. Look, he will bring reward for his people. He will have their payment with him. He takes care of his people like a shepherd. He gathers them like lambs in his arms, and he carries them close to him. He gently leads the mother of the lambs.
This week, our country reached record numbers of death from the coronavirus. We cannot humanly absorb the impact of all those hearts broken open with the magnitude of the loss. Public health experts are warning us that we can expect a hard winter. Thanks to the heroic efforts of scientists, there are vaccines in the works, but it will be several months before they are widely available. And people are suffering from fatigue, fear, and loneliness. And on the second Sunday of Advent, the words of Isaiah help me to wrap myself in their depth. As they have been spoken through the centuries, comfort, comfort, O my people. Our own situation bears some resemblance to that audience of the original prophecy of 2 Isaiah 40. The words comes in the midst of a situation of exile and despair. The people of Judah are in a strange land, far from home, but no one is sure that they can really trust the future. The current situation was one of displacement, anxiety, and suffering. Yes, this year, we are mourning, writes Richard Lisher in the latest issue of Christian Century. He says, we yearn for God with us. The ancient church awaited the final appearance of the Lord with fasting, our ancestors saying, come, thou long-expected Jesus. But today, especially today, we don't pine for a second coming that will bring the world to an end. We pray for the indwelling Christ that will enable the world to continue. Jesus was born into the world, that same world that we inhabit, a world sometimes of misery and misrule, of unspeakable beauty, a planet on which we make and take out our garbage, do our laundry, and we watch for meteors in the night. Yes, Advent is this time of waiting. We are waiting, maybe dreading, this winter. We are always waiting for Christmas, though, of course, but this year with no grandparents, siblings, relatives gathered around a tree, with no safe way to sing those Yuletide carols. We are waiting for a new political climate, new leadership, and a new spirit of cooperation among our politicians. We're waiting for guns to fall silent in our streets, and we are primed and waiting for that vaccine. We are dreaming that Christ will come, not on the clouds of heaven, but with surprises that we in a lifetime of waiting never dream of. For we are hoping that through the faithful efforts of God's people, through some of us, hate will give way to love. And we dream of new ways of living together in peace. Perhaps the question for us is, how much room is there for this one in us? While we are waiting, do we prepare a place for this one to dwell within our very beings? And how do we nurture our longing for Jesus to permeate our lives? Last Sunday, I was impacted by reading the writing of Rachel Brown, who posted an Advent story for reflection, and she gives us permission to share today. She wrote, I am an Advent person. I look forward to this holy time of yearning, of watching, waiting, and preparing. And over the years, I've developed a ritual and a schedule, both sacred and secular. I light candles every Sunday in Advent, adding one each week. I do not go to buy my Christmas tree until after the first Sunday of Advent. There is the first gift of Christmas, the three gifts, and more. However, she said, this year was different. Before Thanksgiving, even, she began thinking about her Christmas tree. She had a conversation with a friend, and they stirred up some excitement together, making plans for meeting and choosing fresh trees from a local tree lot. They each found the perfect tree, one not too tall and nicely shaped, while the other was taller, not too wide at the bottom, and just the right amount of open spaces for the decorations. In all, they purchased 4 trees, piled them into a pickup truck, and within 3 hours, all 4 trees had been delivered and set up in the best spots of 4 different living rooms. Rachel noted that it wasn't even Advent Sunday, and yet the tree stood tall, tall and bare. Though the angel had been placed on the top, for she always was the first to be positioned. And with a mug of warmed mulled cider, Rachel sat with her bare tree and her angel looking down on the scene. After some time of quiet reflection, Rachel decided to put the lights on the tree It was quickly evident that she ran out of lights before the tree was half covered, for this really was the tallest tree she had ever had. Her daughter had extra lights, so finally, with 8 strings of lights and dozens of careful trips up and down the step stool, her tree sparkled. Again, she reflected and sat in amazement. And it wasn't even Advent Sunday yet. Well, last Sunday, on the first Sunday of Advent, Rachel gathered her journal, lit the candle of hope, and turned on the tree lights. The day had arrived. She did her usual drinking coffee, writing, worshiping with the community of faith online, and she meditated. In the afternoon, she brought a box of ornaments upstairs and began to hang them one by one. Each one held a memory, every one different and special. And one box emptied, she took it downstairs and brought up the next. She hung the first layer of ornaments, and she removed the second section. She was totally caught off guard. In fact, she said, I heard myself gasp. In the second layer were all of her deceased husband Dennis's special ornaments. She felt that heaviness sink in her chest. A lump rose in her throat, and she realized she could hardly breathe. So she paused and she stared. Yes, she would need help getting these ornaments on the tree, for grief had overwhelmed her and the tears flowed. She asked herself, why was this year different? She had decorated her Christmas tree 2 Christmases since his death. She piled all of his special ornaments in a basket and took the emptied boxes downstairs. And through her tears, she could see the beauty in front of her. She realized that this was the first time she ever could remember decorating a tree by herself. And then she sat with her grief, tears, thoughts rolling round and round. And again, the question, why was this so different now? And in time, she felt like she understood. This was yet another layer of grief. After her husband's diagnosis of renal cancer, he did not do well. He was not who he was before the diagnosis, and he did not adjust well. And as a couple, she said, they had struggled. But through it all, Rachel had promised him she would not let him die alone. And in May of 2018, she held him close as he died peacefully at home. As she had unwrapped the ornaments, she realized that this year there were hundreds of thousands of people who were not able to keep their promise, and that hundreds of thousands of people have died with no one to hold them as they breathe their last breath. And she wrote, it is beyond my comprehension, yet every hour of every day, here and around the world, it happens. And in that moment, she wept for all those losses more than for her own. She reflected that she shared this not to bear sad tidings, yet there is that recognition that grief is very difficult during the holidays. It may be 3 years, 7 years, 27 years, and this might be the first Christmas without a loved one. But as she has heard many times, the hole left by grief never really goes away. Rachel is certainly not alone. She asks that as we move through this season, that we might remember those who grieve, to reach out, to light a candle for someone who is grieving. And if you don't know anyone, light candles for all those whose loved ones died alone. For this is a time unlike any we have known. And our prayer is that we find ourselves on the other side of this kinder, at peace, and more thoughtful and compassionate, more able to work and walk with each other for the best in all of us. And she closed with these words, "I bid you peace." Yes, Jesus came to bring that peace. And Jesus is always asking us to prepare. For our body holds so many feelings. To repent, to turn around and see the holy break into our lives every day, just as it broke into Rachel's grief last Sunday. We're invited to open our broken hearts to the healing grace of God. And in that space, the light of the holy is kindled. When we say we are preparing for Christmas during Advent in the Christian sense, we are seeking to turn our hearts and our lives more intentionally towards God. It's a way of noticing the places where you can catch a glimpse of the holy. Among each of us whose heart is broken open, God is like a shepherd carrying each of us in his arms. I can't help but think about when I was a little girl and we would go on car trips often past my bedtime. We would pull into the driveway and more times than not, I had fallen asleep in the back seat of our old green Chevy. And I will confess, sometimes I even faked sleep, because what I liked best was for my dad to pick me up in his arms and carry me to my bed, like a shepherd who carries the lambs in his arms. In these days, may you allow yourself to be carried, to receive the balm of the one who says, "Here is your God." May we dream of the path to a deeper sense of inner peace. For when we live with that inner peace, our light will shine more brightly in the world. So live with your heart broken open, so that compassion, caring, and God's reckless love can continue to find a way into your heart. And while we wait, may our prayer continue to be, "Come, Lord Jesus."
Pastor Christy asked me to speak about dreams, about things that make me hopeful in this ridiculous time that we're going through. I am an eternal idealist. I feel like somehow I might get everyone to recycle, and somehow I might get everyone to be considerate drivers, and somehow I might get people to make choices that are good for both themselves and their neighbors, wherever their neighbors may be. It's a little unrealistic at times, but it's part of me, and yeah, it is part of me. So, the bear here. I wanted to take a picture of it to show one of my friends, because I had shown them a picture of what a disaster my room is, because my room is not clean, which is part of why I'm not filming in my room. I'm on my couch in my living room. But they wanted to see this 5-foot stuffed bear. I just grabbed his nose. I'm sorry, I should have chin. They wanted to see the 5-foot stuffed bear. He doesn't have a name yet. I'm taking suggestions if you'd like to. And so I brought him out here and put him on the couch. And I thought, normally I would remove the bear from the couch, but it's 2020. Anything goes, right? So we have a bear on the couch with a bear on the couch. The thing that brings me this joy, this hope for the future, is that 2020 has just turned everything on its head. There is very little that continues to be what we thought it would be and that functions the way it used to. And that gives me hope. I know a lot of institutions and habits have been stuck in their ways for years, generations. And finally, something has come along that has just said, well, I don't care what you think. This is how things need to be right now. We're just going to change it all, and you have to deal with it. And that big speed bump in the road has allowed us to stop and think, has it really been working the way things were? When people talk about post-pandemic life, oftentimes there's the mantra of, I can't wait until things get back to normal. And I am super excited to have things not get back to normal. I am excited to see how employers recognize the value of the people that work for them and the needs they have in their life that a single recent college grad may have all the time in the world to devote to lesson planning if they are a teacher. But someone who has 3 kids under the age of 7 has a 3-ring circus to coordinate while they're trying to teach their own kids at home. It has shed a lot of light on the inequality of the world that we live in. And I hope that those parts don't fall back into the shadows. And that makes me hopeful that we think about what we're actually trying to accomplish and that people aren't robots. We have to care about the human that is behind all work that happens, that the decisions that affect our community need to be considered for everyone, not just for the ones that have a face in front of you. I'm hopeful, and it kind of feels good. I hope you have a lovely stuffed animal to join you for worship this morning.
Let us pray. God of comfort, hope, and peace, as December days grow shorter and the nights grow longer, come quickly to our aching souls. Prepare a new path in our tattered lives. Turn us away from the mundane and the meaningless. Open our ears that we may hear your word afresh, and that with humble and repentant hearts, we might look with anticipation for your continued advent among us. Thank you for your presence, for our community of faith that we worship today with in so many ways and places. We are so aware that nations rage, kingdoms totter, persons seek asylum and protection. Come, Lord Jesus. The fires have destroyed thousands of acres and homes. Hurricanes have blown, floods descended, and we are stunned by the damage. Console the grieving, comfort the caregivers. Come, Lord Jesus. Strokes do come. COVID is diagnosed, surgeries are performed, and for some, breathing stops. We pray for those in our own circle who need your strength and healing power. For Anita, Betty, Ralph, and Jimmy, Paul. Soften the cynical, surprise the hopeless, seal on earth the laughter of children. Come, Lord Jesus. For centuries, O God, your people have anticipated your advent. May the music of our prayer join our song with those of generations before us. Come, Lord Jesus. May it be so.
I'd like to invite you to join us in singing Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus, number 178. We'll do both verses.
May you have the strength to dream wild dreams of justice and peace and joy that overflows. May you have the humanity to listen to the dreams of others. May you have the confidence to trust that the God who heard the cries of the Israelites in Egypt hears your dreams as well. And may you have the conviction to return to this space. For our best dreams are those that we dream together, whether we're physically together or apart. May you continue to seek God's peace. Amen.